for a moment more than 30 seconds on my memories here. Okay. Now, Uncle Thomas and I, we didn't talk just a whole lot until later, you know, in life, but this is what I remember growing up. Every Thursday, my mom would go get her hair done by Uncle Thomas, and then they would go out to eat. Remember, they loved Chinese. I'm sad Queen couldn't be there because she could probably remember a lot of this stuff better than I could. And then eventually she got, so she'd just go maybe once a month or so and get her hair cut and perm. But when I was little, it was every week occurrence. And I can remember, she looked forward to those evenings, and then every now and then we'd go to Uncle Thomas's house. I don't know if you guys have been to Uncle Thomas's house, but we always had to talk, do you not touch anything at this, you know? Especially the queen, because I, you know, she was the one. But I can remember once, we somehow managed, we did my boat, to get ourselves locked in the bathroom. And, you know, my mom, you know, I could hear her stress and Uncle Thomas's frustration. And then there was always Jim. Do you guys remember Jim? He was always laughing and happy and smiling. And he was over, you know, trying to make light of everything. And, you know, I was afraid I was going to get beat when I got out of there. But he was laughing and making light of it as they were coming to take the door off to get us out. And, you know, we were just in there. So that's one of my memories of Uncle Thomas's house. He had beautiful antiques all over, and his house was definitely up to par. Let's see. Okay, what I remember at Uncle Thomas's house that I loved was his courtyard. And I don't know if I only saw it once, but it made such an impression on me. And I asked Quita, did she remember it? She kind of had a vague memory, too. I don't know. But it was green, and it was kind of private, and it was just flowers and ivy everywhere. And I can remember a little white bench that just looked like it had been there forever. Yeah, yeah. And I'm looking forward next week to going back over there and seeing if it's still there or whatever. But I just remember loving that. And flowers would be what we eventually always talked about, because I love flowers, he loved flowers, so that would be our conversation, usually, when we got together. When I got married 30 years ago, I had my reception at Uncle Thomas's house, and I can remember all the times when we were little, we would come up the back stairs and into the kind of kitchen area, you know, and we would never go into the front room, which was white carpet, the fancy white, you know, Victorian furniture, the baby grand piano, with the chandelier, just elegance. That's how I remember it. It's been a long time. But that day for my reception, we got to go up the staircase in the front. We got to go in, and it was lovely. And he had it all beautiful and everything and sparkly. Anyway, I remember that, and that was probably the last time that I was there. Anyway, it wasn't until my mom was in the hospital about 10 years ago that I really started to visit with Uncle Thomas. The first week before Aunt Juanita got there, he and I were together quite a bit. And as we visited, I remember thinking that we had a lot in common. He and I were probably the serious ones, and Quita was always that silly, laughing, joyful one. And I think that was what really Jim was to him. He was always, you know, the fun one, and Uncle Thomas and I were the serious ones. And I remember thinking, we're so much alike, you know? I'm thinking that was so funny. And I remember, I didn't write this down, but since I didn't know I was going to be the only one talking about feelings. Because I didn't write this down because it didn't sound too well, but I remember, at the Willow House, as everyone was having children except for me, I can remember sometimes these mothers and children, they would do kind of questionable things. Well, not you, right on it. I just remember that. And Uncle Thomas and I, we'd always meet eyes like, what are they thinking? And then I had my own child, and I had to stop making eye contact. I knew what they were thinking. Let's not have a meltdown right here in front of everybody. Anyway, but I thought that was funny, because we would always meet eyes like... So that was just he and I. We really were put up with a lot. Which I wouldn't have seen that, you know, but when we were talking. Yeah, so we talked a bit. And he seemed to enjoy traveling. And I don't remember, but I love to travel, and I'm not very good at small talk, so that's what I always ask. Are you taking me trips? Do you love to travel? And I say, you love to travel. So that's what. But we talked about traveling, and he loved to travel. And I remember we talked about how we like to save the money first and then go and never go in debt. That's a big, you know, I'm always harping on that. It's kind of like, where's Mike? You probably heard more than 300 times or so about what I am. But anyway, so we were talking about that, and he seemed to agree. I don't know that he really talked about it, but... He said he enjoyed, I remember this little tidbit of conversation, that he enjoyed saving up money and getting nice, I remember he liked nice rings. So I'm sure you guys know so much more than I do, but these are all bits and pieces of memories that I remember. He liked nice rings. Anyway, after my mom passed away, Uncle Thomas started coming over once or twice And he would catch me up on Aunt Red and Terry and Tawny, because that was when Tawny was there with you or whatever. And then, you know, I kind of knew about Aunt Juanita because she calls, you know, 3 or 4 times a year. Kathy writes me every month and kind of keeps me up on what everybody's doing. So that was lovely. But we would always visit and have plenty of things to visit about. And then at the very end, he would always say, okay, let's go look at your flowers. So we would start on one side of my house, and we would talk about every plant, every flower, and we'd go all the way up, and then in the front, and then all the way, and then all the way in the back. And in the back, there was hardly nothing, you know, for years, but it was like, what I was going to do. I'm going to do this, and this, and this, and he could see it in his eye like I could. And we'd talk about this and that, anything that would spread, because we love plants. I'm like, well, do you want some of this? Well, sure. So I get a little Walmart sack and a shovel and dip some up, because he was going to go home and plant it in his and let it spread. And he would always bring money to help out with the willow house, usually after he'd been here at Easter or something. So he was very generous. And I can remember pulling up one day, and there was all of these little pots of plants. And I was so excited, and Jared's like, well, he brought this too. And I'm like, oh, my goodness, look at these purple plants. So it was just, that was just our thing. And I just didn't know anyone who loved plants quite like I do, like Uncle Thomas did. So it was so much fun, and I looked forward to that every time. Anyway, I have some of Aunt Katie's plants in my yard because he brought those over, and that was pretty fun. But we never seem to run out of things to visit about because we love talking about flowers so much, and I will miss our visits very much. Anyway, that's my memories. So I will say my little prayer. Everyone said to write it down. And then if anybody wants to share now, or if they want to share the memorial, that would be fine too. Okay. If you will join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you and we praise your name. Psalms 100 says, know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. We enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. We give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. We thank you for this time when we can come together. Thank you for Uncle Thomas's love. Thank you that he was able to surround himself with beautiful things, to make a living doing work that he enjoyed, to spend time in his garden surrounded with flowers that he loved. Uncle Thomas had many friends and family who loved him. He lived a beautiful, happy life, and we thank you for the joy he brought into our lives and for all the good memories he left behind. Thank you so much that you are a God of hope and encouragement, and that you comfort us when our hearts are sad. Joy, peace, and hope, and blessing for you. In Jesus' name, amen. I wanted to say one more thing. As I was trying to think, what would I say? It just occurred to me, of course you probably all know, but when my mother died, it's like I took all of you as for granted up to that point. It's like, okay, you're my family, so you know, whatever. But when my mother died, everybody became so precious. And it's just that you guys are a wonderful family. I mean, we're always so close, especially to Sam. I mean, I don't know you guys quite as well, but you're lovely too. But I just think Uncle Thomas, I mean, he had sisters, and, you know, we just all loved him, and he was in a family, and I just feel so blessed to have all of you as my family. So I just know that you did too, and I just think you had a wonderful life. And Aunt Retta said last night he lived it his way, and he did, and he just...
When y'all see that tomorrow, you will see. Paul and them, they done a wonderful job with the Philip, with all of the pictures and everything. And I watched that last night twice. And it is so super because it just shows. And we've all forgotten how good looking he was when he was young.
And
Juanita and Paula got all these pictures together, and from the time that he was young and just so handsome and bald, you know, just looked so good, and in all these pictures, and I think that will be showing. Debbie's going to have that going down at the memorial, and y'all will get to see him when he was young, because so many of y'all are didn't know him at that time, like we did when we were all growing up, and he was always just the one that was dressed to the ninth, and, you know, the one that just always super, and he tended to everybody. On Mother's Day, he always brought chrysanthemums to Aunt Katie, to Mother, and to Grandmother Cook. And he always gave them corsages, too. And he was just such a giving person. And any time that I had anything at school, I always knew that I was going to be the most super dressed one because he bought all of my formals. I had formal for any occasion. I had the shoes that matched it, the bag on the little chain. He was just super at always being sure that I had, because I mean we didn't have the money to have that, but after we grew up, I mean everybody else left and everybody just tended to me. I was the spoiled one.
You were the baby.
I was the baby. But I can just remember of all the times that he would bring outfit. And then one of the times, we'd have to send those measurements, you know. And so, anyway, he found this dress. And I was 29 in the waist at the time. And he measured and he said, it's 28. You can just lose 10 pounds. He said, I bought this. And of course, I had the, you know, that was my junior year. And I had the shoes and it was an orange thing with chiffon overlay, everything matching, yes. But anyway, I just remember because, you know, I'd have to take those measurements so that he'd know. And like I said, I always had the big rear, but I used to have a small waist. You know, it was a flare tail dress. Well, it was a 28, so just get with it. So I did. I fit in it.
We did good.
But Thomas was always so generous with just everything. He just tended to people, and his friends, they all tended to each other. As everybody got sick, he was one of the last ones left, and of his friends, and he had known all these people since in the 60s, and I know about, and they, like I said, they were just down to, he had tended to Buzz for weeks in the hospital, and when Thomas got in the hospital, Buzz was finally relieved to drive, and then he started coming to see Thomas, and Buzz and Lon will be there at 1, and Jim was Thomas's favorite best friend, but he died, I think, not very long ago.
January.
So that was a sad thing, but y'all all remember him because he was here a lot. But anyway, Jim was the one that was Thomas's special friend. All of these others were just friends, but they all tended to each other. And Thomas, in his younger years, always enjoyed fancy cars. I can remember him having a 54 Oldsmobile, and then they was big as a tank.
And he had a new one every year.
Yeah, and he had and he'd have a new one. But he did. He always. But anyway, that's part of my memories.
And well, I didn't think I was going to have any, but I have to say, too, that, of course, he was 2 years older than I was, and so we were always close together. And as we grew up, and especially as we got into the late 40s when we were teenagers, and at that time is when he started doing hair, and we had a hair blower at home, and he would fix my hair the last 2 years of school, and I was always, looked so good. And we had ball games, usually every Friday, and so on that day, he would curl my hair the night before, and everybody in school did it, and he curled it, and then you put a scarf around your hair, and you went to school. So when you went for your ball game, oh, you look really good. And he always thought, and he started helping me by that time to say, that looks good and that doesn't look good, you know. And as he left, and we weren't as close for several years because, you know, we're raising the family and I was always out of town. But every time we met almost, we always came back at least once a year or so. And he always had something for me. And one thing, that this was one thing he brought me one time. He would go to these antique sales, and he just thought that looked like me. And I have 4 gold braces that he had bought, and other type things that he had too. And I remember one year, he brought me 3 cashmere sweaters. And I wore those for, you know, several years. And And we were closer more probably the past the last couple of years, and we got so that we talked over the phone at least one time a week, and sometime we'd talk two or three times a week. And when we call, we mostly were reminiscing about our upbringing and all these things, you know. And so I you know, I've always felt very close to him, and
dating a girl kind of stuff.
I feel like I got to visit just a little bit more. I mean, we always get here. We have all the, I don't want to call it work, but we have all the preparations for the reunion, and we get everything done. And then Sunday night, after everything's quiet, we get in and we get our glass of wine. And we'd all just, Mama and Paula was here that year, and Uncle Thomas and I, or whoever was there. We just have our glass of wine, and I kind of listen to Mama and Uncle Thomas reminisce about things. And I don't know, I just felt like I got to know him just a little bit better over the last 2 years than before. And I do have a couple memories, I think, from when I was little, because we lived in Oklahoma City, but I was only five. But I kind of remember being at his house. And I hate to say it, I have one memory that I think I knocked something over and broke it.
Somebody no, that was Quita. That was,
oh, was that Quita? That was Quita. She's not here. But in my mind, I did that, and that just...
You were probably around somewhere.
I said, well, and if his house was, that was during the years when everything was perfect. Yeah. I mean...
But that was, hey, that wasn't the house that he's in now. That was the one that was before. Well, I remember the time. I mean, this is the one that had the staircase that went up and stuff like that, and it was pretty cramped with items also.
But at that time, he got, so when he closed that antique shop, he moved all that in. It was going to be him. And then that was the fun. But he did. He enjoyed. No one ever at done
different times.
I have heard that song with Thomas, and he enjoyed it. So that's why we chose it.
Well, I think for me, it was younger days and kind of, you know, probably 20 years ago that I had more meaningful conversations with him. I mean, when we were young, that was the, you know, in Oklahoma City, that was the, Uncle Thomas was taking me home and spend the night, and, you know, you always got a good dinner, and he always took care of you, and it was just always a special time. Oh, gave you money. I mean, you know, everybody else would give you a dollar, he'd give you five. That was pretty exciting, you know, way back when. But, you know, what really struck me in the later years, and as I came through before I got married, and which was when I first went in the Air Force, I'd come through a couple times, had dinner with him, and it's just so, you know, it was so much how much he appreciated his sisters and brothers. I mean,
he was always appreciative.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, and the only time he ever got on me is I spent the night with him one time when I was a kid, and I wanted scrambled eggs in the morning, and somehow the salt shaker went crazy, and he didn't have much ketchup, and I wasn't going to eat them, but I ended up eating them. It was quite the traumatic time, but that was, I guess, the only time that I can ever remember being disciplined by, I think everybody else had their shot, uncles and aunts disciplining me, but that was the only time I think I remember, but, you know, it's really fond, and I just will miss him.
And it occurred to me that the last time I did 140 miles, I was like, no shit. Mm-hmm. After his stroke, I went picking him up in a brand new Camaro, and I was bringing him up to him. And me being the show off was, as we were getting on I-40 there in Oklahoma City, got fast as I could, I got up to 120. I didn't tell him I got up to 120, but, you know, I mean, I wanted him to feel himself over. And I slowed right back down. But it occurred to me a moment ago, kind of like, well, I haven't done that.
He always enjoyed
it. Oh, he liked the fast.
He liked
the
car.
He did. He told me that.
He told you I took it.
Oh, no, he didn't say that part. No, but he was just so glad that you come in. He loved the car, not because he always enjoyed cars, but then, like, he went to have the car again because he thought that would be wasted money. But the last year, we talked him into getting another little car. He got that from his crew. He's very proud of it.
That's fine.
Okay, that's a good one. David was talking about the grandstand. If you have a business, you have an ordinance one time with the foot pedals. That's what I remember. He was glad to see us, but he couldn't deal with it too much longer. So he said, okay, I'm leaving. Yeah, I didn't know that. I just snuck in there. He's always leaving us when we come in the city and always taking us to lunch when we come in before we come down to Willow. We always film at you three more times. Right. So she came back behind, you know, she went, that was Thomas that was here. Yeah. He had no more than he left him alone. I need to get her anything.